In the last video, we proved that if L over K is a finite extension, then the group of automorphisms of L fixing K is a finite group. But we want to know more. We want to know how big this group actually is. And the starting point for understanding this question is going to be a theorem that we proved a few lectures ago when we were trying to show that any two splitting fields for a polynomial are isomorphic to each other. This was theorem 27 in section 13.4. And this built on an even earlier result that we proved in this direction. So what's the setup? Is we let sigma be an isomorphism of fields from F to F prime. And we have some polynomial F of X in F bracket X and the corresponding polynomial sigma of F of X in F prime bracket X. This is the polynomial we get by applying sigma to the coefficients of F. We take a splitting field E for F of X over F and E prime a splitting field for sigma of F of X over F prime. And what we proved is that there is an isomorphism psi from E to E prime such that the restriction of psi to F is this isomorphism sigma that we started with. So we proved that there was one such isomorphism. And in this case, we'll say that sigma is an extension, that psi is an extension of sigma, because psi is an isomorphism where you restrict it down to the domain of sigma and you get sigma. Okay, so why did we prove this at that point? Then taking the special case where F equals F prime and sigma is the identity isomorphism, we saw that we got some isomorphism between one splitting field for F of X over F and another splitting field for F of X over F. So this showed that any two splitting fields for F of X over F were isomorphic to each other. So what we want to prove now is a theorem about not just that there exists one isomorphism with this property, but to count them. So this theorem is proven on pages 561 to 562 of section 14.1 of Dumb and Foot. It doesn't get highlighted as its own result, but I want to state it here because it's like the main thing that we're doing right now. So I'll just call it theorem star. And what we're going to prove is that the number of such extensions, psi, from E to E prime is at most the degree of E over F. So what does that really mean? The number of isomorphisms from E to E prime such that the restriction of psi to F is this original isomorphism sigma is at most the degree E over F. And if E over F is separable, then the number of such extensions is equal to the degree of E over F. So we always have this upper bound. And if we put in an additional separability assumption, we get inequality. Okay, why is this so important? Well, you can prove directly from this result, proposition 5 in section 14.1, which says, let F of X be a polynomial in F bracket X, and E be a splitting field for F of X over F. Then the size of the group of automorphisms of E fixing F is at most the degree of E over F, and equality holds if F of X is separable over F. Okay, so this is the kind of result that we want to prove. We want to give a bound on the size of this group of automorphisms, and even better, under an additional assumption, separability assumption, we're not just giving a bound, but we know the size of this group of automorphisms. It is the degree of this field extension. So I'm going to prove proposition 5, assuming theorem star. So we're going to apply this theorem in the special case where F equals F prime, sigma is the identity isomorphism from F to itself. And in that case, what is the relationship between F and sigma F? Well, they're the same. These are the same polynomial. So in that case, what's happening is E is a splitting field for F of X over F, and E prime is a splitting field for F of X over F. We know that any two such splitting fields are isomorphic, but one instance in which we could apply this theorem is the case where E and E prime are actually the same. So let's suppose F equals F prime, sigma equals the identity, and then E equals E prime also. In this case, what is this theorem saying? It's saying the number of extensions of the identity isomorphism from F to itself is at most the degree of E over F. And if this extension is separable, then the number of such extensions is actually equal to the degree. Well, what we're seeing is, okay, so what is, if you have one of these extensions, what does that mean? You have an isomorphism from E to itself. So it's an automorphism of E. And when you take the restriction to F, you get sigma, which is the identity isomorphism. So psi restricted to F is the identity. So psi fixes everything in F. So any one of these extensions is an automorphism of E that fixes F. So the only other thing that we need to note here is that, okay, equality holds if F of X is separable over F, is that if F of X is a separable polynomial, then the splitting field of F of X over F is a separable extension. Okay, so I'm going to pause and erase, and I'll talk about some other consequences and related issues around theorem star, and then we'll prove it. Once we prove theorem star, we'll know that the order of the group of automorphisms of E fixing F is at most the degree of E over F. In this case, where E is a splitting field for a polynomial F of X over F. But more generally, it is true that for any finite extension, K over F, the size of the group of automorphisms of K fixing F is at most the degree of this extension. This is not only true when K is a splitting field for some polynomial F of X in F bracket X. So this is something that we'll come back to in a few lectures. This is corollary 10 in section 14.2. So we'll come back to this and So in certain nice cases, we know that the size of this group of automorphisms is equal to the extension, the degree of this extension of fields. That gets a special name. Let's say that K over F is a finite extension. We say that K is Galois over F, and K over F is a Galois extension if the size of the group of automorphisms of K fixing F is the degree of K over F. And in this case, where K over F is Galois, and we have this group of automorphisms of K fixing F, we know the order is equal to the degree of this field extension. This group gets a special name. This is called the Galois group of K over F and is denoted Gal K over F. Okay, so now if you believe this statement, this theorem star, then this definition, this big definition that motivates a lot of what Galois theory is all about makes sense. So we now understand what it means for an extension, a finite extension, to be a Galois extension. It means that the order of the group of automorphisms of K fixing F is the degree of K over F. All right, so a direct corollary of proposition 5 that we just proved using this language is that if F of X in F bracket X is separable and K is a splitting field for F of X over F, then K over F is a Galois extension. Okay, you could ask, well, what about the converse? If I have a Galois extension, is it necessarily true that K is the splitting field for some polynomial F of X over F? And the converse is true. And this is something that we'll come back to in a few lectures. This is some part of theorem 13 in section 14.2. Okay. So what do we need to do? We just need to prove this theorem star about the number of extensions of our isomorphism sigma between F and F prime. And the big idea is going to be induction on the degree of this extension, the degree of E over F, the degree of the splitting field over F. And the base case is easy. When this degree is one, when the splitting field is actually equal to F, then okay, E equals F, E prime equals F prime. And if psi is an extension of sigma, then psi restricted to F equals sigma, but E equals F. So psi restricted to F is psi. So psi equals sigma everywhere. So there is one isomorphism, psi, between E and E prime, that when you restrict it to F, you get sigma. And that is psi equals sigma. There's always exactly one. So the number of these extensions is one, which is the degree of E over F. Okay. So, yeah. Okay. So this proves the statement in the base case. I'll pause and erase, and we'll do the proof of theorem star. We've proven the base case of this result. Now let's suppose that the degree of E over F is at least one. So in that case, if we have a splitting field that has degree at least, sorry, not at least one, great, actually greater than one. So what does that mean about F of X? That means that F of X has a root that's not already an F. So F of X has to have at least one irreducible factor, P of X, of degree at least two. And sigma of P of X is an irreducible factor of sigma of F of X, and they have the same degree. The degree of P and the degree of sigma of P are equal. So this is something that we've already seen, like in our argument to prove this theorem 27 in section 13.4. This is the kind of thing that we looked at. Let's say that alpha is a root of P of X. So it's contained in E because E is a splitting field for F of X, and P of X is an irreducible factor of F. So every root of P of X is also a root of F. And let's suppose that we have one of these extensions that we're looking for. So an isomorphism psi from E to E prime, where you restrict it down to F and you get this original isomorphism sigma from F to F prime. We have this intermediate field, F adjoint alpha, between E and F. And because we have an isomorphism psi from E to E prime, psi restricted to F adjoint alpha is an isomorphism of this field with some subfield of E prime. So we're going to name this isomorphism, the one that we get by taking psi and restricting it to F adjoint alpha. This is tau. And you can see that tau is completely determined by where it sends alpha. So you know that psi restricted to F is sigma. So tau restricted to F is sigma also. And so you already know what tau does to the elements of F. If you know what tau does to alpha, that tells you what tau does to any element of F adjoint alpha, because we have this nice description of elements of F adjoint alpha as polynomials in alpha with coefficients in F. Okay, so you should check, this is true, but there's something to check and you should do it, that tau of alpha, we don't just get to choose anything for what that can be, that has to be a root of sigma of P of X. So alpha is a root of P of X. This isomorphism tau has to send it to a root of sigma of P of X. And let's name that root. Let's say that it's beta. So why is this true? It's the same idea as in the proof of theorem 2.4 from last lecture, where we saw that if you had a polynomial in F bracket X, that an automorphism of L fix or a K fixing F has to send a root of F of X to another root of F of X. Okay, so you should really think about this. And what does that give? Well, if tau of alpha is beta, then the image of f adjoin alpha under this isomorphism tau is f prime adjoin beta. And again, you should convince yourself that this is actually true. Now, this gives a diagram where we have this isomorphism at the top, psi from e to e prime, that restricts down to, you restrict it down to f, and you get this original isomorphism sigma from f to f prime. And you have this intermediate field, f adjoin alpha, and psi restricted to f adjoin alpha is this isomorphism tau between f adjoin alpha and f prime adjoin beta. Okay, so the big idea is that we want to count the number of these extensions psi. For any one of these extensions psi, we get a diagram that looks like this. So what we want to do is we want to count extensions by counting diagrams of this form. So I'll pause and erase and make this idea a little more precise. Where are we in this argument? If we have an extension psi of this sigma, so an isomorphism from e to e prime that you restrict it to f and you get sigma, and alpha is some root of this irreducible factor p of x of f of x, then psi restricted to f adjoin alpha gives an isomorphism to some subfield of e prime. Let's call that tau. And we've seen that tau is determined by where it sends alpha. And tau of alpha has to be a root of the polynomial sigma of p of x. So let's call that root beta. So this isomorphism tau goes from f adjoin alpha to f prime adjoin beta, where beta is tau of alpha. Okay, so if we have such an extension of sigma, we get a diagram that looks like this. So this is the big idea. We're going to count the extensions of sigma, these isomorphisms psi, by counting these diagrams. Like, how many ways could we make a diagram like this? But one thing that we should check first to make sure that this is okay is, okay, we said that tau has to send alpha to some root of sigma of p of x, but can we always find a tau that sends alpha to a particular choice of root? So let's just suppose that beta is a root of sigma of p of x. So these theorems that we proved earlier, including this one that we stated, this theorem 27 in section 13.4, these theorems say that there is an isomorphism psi from e to e prime, giving the diagram above, that okay, we do have, for one thing, theorem 8 says that there does exist an isomorphism tau that takes f adjoin alpha to f prime adjoin beta, where beta is just any root we want of sigma of p of x, that you restrict and you get sigma. And then this theorem 27 about splitting fields, isomorphisms of splitting fields, says that there really does exist an isomorphism psi from e to e prime that restricts down to sigma. Okay, so now we want to count. So this is the big idea. The number of extensions of sigma up to this level to an isomorphism tau, well, for any, it's determined, such an isomorphism tau is determined by where it sends alpha. And we know that alpha needs to get sent to a root of sigma of p of x. And for every choice of such a root, there is one isomorphism of f adjoin alpha to f prime adjoin beta, such that when you restrict it, you get the isomorphism sigma from f to f prime. Why? Because tau is determined by where it sends alpha. So once you pick what beta is, there's nothing else to pick. You've completely determined this isomorphism. So how many choices are there for beta? It's the number of distinct roots of sigma of p of x in a splitting field for this polynomial. Okay, well, since E is a splitting field for f of x over f, it is also a splitting field for f of x over f adjoint alpha. So think about it. It is an extension of f adjoint alpha in which f of x factors completely into a product of linear factors. And if there was a proper subfield of E that had this property, then E wouldn't have been a splitting field for f of x over f to begin with. This is an argument that we already saw when we were proving this theorem 27 in section 13.4. And similarly, E prime is a splitting field for sigma of f of x over f prime adjoint beta for any choice of a root beta of sigma of p of x. All right, so why are we saying this now? Is we know the number of isomorphisms tau here in this diagram that extend this isomorphism sigma. And to determine the number of isomorphisms psi that extend this isomorphism sigma, we're going to apply the induction hypothesis to this part of the diagram, that the key observation is that because alpha is a root of an irreducible polynomial of degree at least two, an irreducible factor of degree at least two of f of x, the degree of E over f adjoint alpha is less than the degree of E over f. So we're going to apply the induction hypothesis to this part of the diagram. So we're going to determine the number of isomorphism psi from E to E prime, such that you restrict them to f adjoint alpha and you get this isomorphism tau. Okay, so I'll pause and erase and I'll clearly state what the induction hypothesis applied here gets you and finish this proof. What do we get when we apply the induction hypothesis to this part of the diagram? This tells us that the number of extensions psi, isomorphisms from E to E prime, extending tau, so you restrict psi down to f adjoint alpha and you get tau, is at most the degree of E over f adjoint alpha with equality if f of x has distinct roots in E. And okay, so how do we put these two parts of the diagram together? The degree of E over F is the degree of E over F adjoint alpha times the degree of F adjoint alpha over F. So the number of extensions psi of sigma is at most the degree of E over F, because the number of extensions tau of sigma is at most the number of distinct roots of P of X in a splitting field. So it's at most the degree of F adjoint alpha over f, because this degree is the degree of p of x. So the number of roots is at most that degree. And this term we just saw is an upper bound for isomorphisms psi restricting, extending tau. Okay, so where do we get equality? You can see that we get equality in the number of extensions tau of sigma if p of x has distinct roots in E. And we get equality in this term if f of x has distinct roots in E. But p of x is an irreducible factor of f of x. So if f of x has distinct roots in E, then every root of p of x is automatically a root in f. If f of x has distinct roots, then certainly p of x has distinct roots. So so we have equality if f of x has distinct roots in E, that this additional requirement that p of x has distinct roots in E doesn't add anything. So what are we seeing? Is that equality holds in this number of isomorphisms from e to e prime, extending sigma, if f of x has distinct roots in e, that is, if f of x is a separable polynomial in f bracket x. So let me just say, this argument is long and a little bit complicated and very much builds on some of the longer, more challenging arguments that we saw earlier in the course. I think that it's important that you think about it, and this idea of counting the number of isomorphisms extending a given isomorphism, but this is not the kind of argument that you would be asked to reproduce on an exam.